Soundings presents an unabridged recording of The Girl I Left Behind, written by Andie Newton, read by Julia Barrie. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Soundings. Historical note. Hidden inside Nazi Germany, deep within the fabric of society, groups of rebels risked their lives defying the laws of the Third Reich. Many were young people, children who grew up in Hitler's Germany, where Nazi indoctrination started in kindergarten. As these children reached adulthood, they realized that what they had been taught to admire wasn't worth admiring after all, and they resented the way the Nazi Party tried to control all facets of their life. These nonconformists were the resistors of Nazism, the youth of the German resistance. Prologue, 1943, Germany. The man was a spy. This much he would have admitted, but only if the ropes had tightened just a hair more around his wrists, or if the water they threw on him had got any colder. There was, after all, only so much torture a man could take in Nazi Germany before his defences would break and his British accent would betray him. The Gestapo had perfected their torture techniques, and contrary to belief, they liked to use the dullest knives, not the sharpest. The dull ones caused more pain and had been proven to yield much more information. Luckily enough for the man, informants hadn't learned this technique, and while they decided on the best approach for extraction, the man had wiggled out from the ropes that bound him, reached for the dagger he always carried in a sheath above his right ankle, and killed his way out of the Munich storage room where they'd held him captive. He dared not go home to his flat, for fear they'd already discovered where he lived. Instead, he broke for the side exit, shuffling down the long corridor the best he could with an injured leg that caused him to limp. A trample roared just above him one floor up, and he listened, with his eyes to the ceiling, counting the thumps, deciding how many informants were on the verge of discovering he'd got away. He limped on at a galloping rate, knowing his own hobbling could be heard, and burst out the side doors into the dark alley, tripping into some rubbish bins that hadn't been emptied. A cat screeched from somewhere, and he stumbled forward, rushing toward his contact, who'd been waiting for him outside for more than an hour. A girl, a shop girl, she had told him not long ago, who gleamed like a new coin in the night. She waved the bouquet she'd bought earlier, concealing the intelligence tucked inside. "Where have you been?" she said, and he snatched the flowers from her hands. His throat was dry, and try as he might, he didn't have the strength to tell her he'd been caught. But he did have the sense to tell her to run, and she took off in the other direction. The man rounded the corner onto the street, and for a moment breathed a sigh of relief, thinking he'd outsmarted the informants, and that his spy was safe. He took a deep breath, but then slumped forward from a surprise life-ending stab to his abdomen. The informant yanked the bouquet from the man's hands, laughing as he pulled his knife back, letting the man walk his last humiliating steps into a crowded square where he would die. And when the man fell onto the cobblestones, people stopped and stared. To his horror, just when he was about to take his last gurgling breath, the girl he'd told to run leaned over his body and looked into his eyes. He saw the shock on her face, and then heard it from the others when English words spilled from his lips. As she covered her mouth watching him die, his last thought was not one of shame for having been caught, but of guilt, because he'd remembered that hidden under his mattress with his notes, he had scrawled her name on a piece of paper. 1941. Chapter 1. October. Nuremberg. I hurried through the crowded streets of Nuremberg, checking my watch every few seconds as the hands moved closer and closer to 7 o'clock. The League of German Girls didn't wait for late arrivals, and if I missed Frau Dankwart's opening remarks, I'd hear about it from Aunt Bridget, who'd die from embarrassment if I showed up tardy again. I had one job to do this evening, and that was to close up my aunt's antique shop in time to make my league meeting. I didn't account for an unexpected customer who couldn't make up her mind, and then having the terrible misfortune of using my aunt's cramped office to change into my league uniform. I rounded a corner, getting ready to cross the street, but then bumped right into a child, knocking the poor boy to the ground. He lay paralyzed with fear, eyes wide and unblinking, with his little hands clinging to his sides. I went to help him up, and that's when the yellow star sewn on his left breast shone up like a beam of light in the gloaming just before his curfew. His mother screamed silently, hands to her mouth for the attention he caused, probably wondering if I was going to alert the policeman directing traffic nearby in the square. "It wasn't his fault," I said to his mother. I looked back at the policeman, who hadn't seen a thing. "Go!" And they walked into a sea of foot traffic, disappearing between the bodies. I ran across the street. Only that same policeman who'd been directing traffic had blown his whistle. Someone else took his post, and he walked up to me, hand gripping his billy club close to his side. I closed my eyes briefly, mad at myself, knowing I shouldn't have been running. I smoothed my tie flat.
"Who are you running from?"
He reached for my elbow, but I'd unbuttoned my coat just enough to show him my league uniform, thick blue tie and white shirt, which had actually started to dull, much to Auntie's dismay. "I'm late for my league meeting. I'm sorry." Bystanders shot me strange looks, some probably hoping I'd be dragged away, give them a sight to see. He looked at his watch, tapping the crystal.
"At this hour?"
He squinted. I gulped, knowing his questions could go on indefinitely if he wanted. I tried not to sound impatient. "I work at my aunt's shop. This is the first time I had to close and make a league meeting right after." I hung my head down. "I should have planned better."
"What shop?"
He tipped his helmet up, looking down the street and past the Nazi flags hanging above shop windows. I pointed. "The antique shop just there, next to the old beer cellar with the red door."
"I know of it."
He sounded bored, and then quickly spotted someone else to go after. An old man with a cane on the other side of the street who moved much too fast for his age.
"Be off now,"
he said, pulling out his stick and heading across the street. I turned away, not wanting to see what was about to come next. I took a deep breath once I'd made it to Frau Dankwart's house. All was quiet. The rest of the girls were already inside. I straightened my jacket and smoothed my hair back, if only to look less hurried. I went to knock on her tall black door and was suddenly thrown back to the first day I'd met her. My parents had only just died when my aunt told me she'd enrolled me in the League of German Girls, the female branch of the Hitler Youth. She said my mother had broken the law, since membership was compulsory. When I told her I wasn't a National Socialist, she shushed me. That was 5 years ago. Now it was only a matter of weeks before I turned 18, and I'd graduate out of the League. I rapped once, and the door flew open. Frau Dankwart's rail-thin body stood like a pole in the doorway, her dark eyes sinking into her face.
"Ella Strauss," she said. "Glad you finally arrived."
Her voice was stern, and I fully expected her to scold me. But then she threw a wrinkly old finger into the air, pointing at her parlour.
"Get inside. We're reading Mein Kampf,"
she said, as if I thought we'd be reading something else.
"You almost missed my opening remarks."
Yes, ma'am, sorry, pardon me, I said, and I slipped past her through the door. Frau Dankwart's sitting parlour had been rearranged to look more like a classroom during league meetings. The most devout league girls sat at the desks. The one she hadn't made up her mind about sat at the tables off to the side, and the one she had little hope for sat on the floor, way in the back in the draughtiest part of the room. I made my way to the back. I tripped on a ripple in the rug and bumped into a girl's desk. She looked up from her book, sniffing and snivelling, wiping tears from her eyes.
I'm in love with the Führer, she gushed.
I patted her arm and continued to the back of the room, where my friend Claudia sat crisscross on the floor waiting for me, her auburn hair twisted over one shoulder. I sat down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.